Those are just the first prototype of the special stuff. Yeah. Well, that's why I wanted to make it punch it that too, but they don't know how to do it properly here. I gotta go to Kerala.
Experiment to show first that circuit worked as a just an unbroken circuit. Then I put that circuit into water which was distilled, so it's empty water and it wasn't conducting any electricity. And then putting in salt, then the connection started again. So showing that we need minerals inside this water to conduct electricity. So the basics of where I want to start. So when we think about what we're made from, mostly water, oxygen, we need things inside of us to conduct electricity. So then we have to look to understanding what is matter. So according to a scientist called George Lakofsky, he stated that the human body had approximately 200 quintillion cells. And each one of those cells is containing about two-thirds water, which is made of 80% oxygen. And that's also containing minerals and elements and metals, which is equal to seawater. So that's our basic components of what we're made out of. I'm just doing real basics for this time. So breaking down what is matter, a chemical is any pure substance consisting of matter. So that's including liquid, solid, and gas. And a molecule is the smallest part of the chemical. And molecules are made up of atoms, and they're held together by the chemical bonds formed as a result of sharing and exchanging electrons among the atoms. So the atoms have a nucleus, protons with a positive charge, and electrons with a negative charge. And the movement of the electrons is generating electricity through kinetic movement, which is when you're actually moving your body. So by moving your body, doing exercise yoga, you're actually generating electrons or generating electricity. So a periodic table of elements, which we all have inside of us, they're basically ingredients that we have inside our body to run our cells. If we don't have ingredients in our cells, we're not able to do all of the functions that we need for life. Different molecular ingredients will produce different types of cells, capable of different types of functions. They'll also produce different movements, physicality, based on those structures. And then, based on that, they're going to put out different frequencies, different frequency outputs. And no one cell is alike. just like there's a lot, a whole millions and millions of humans, no one human is alike, no one cell is alike either. And that's based on the structure of the cell. So this is a photograph of human bone. And you can see right at this microscopic level that it's containing a whole lot of rainbows, so different frequency levels represented in colour, and this is human bone. So depending on the structure, the things that you're made out of, your function is going to be different. So this is a map produced by my mentor. I do Chinese medicine and acupuncture, and my mentor is the same. So it's showing the basic ingredients for making hormones. So if you're coming right to the top, we've got cholesterol, dietary fats, what you're putting in, vitamins and other minerals, go down to produce premelanone, which is the mother hormone, which then goes on to produce the progesterone, the DHEA, and sort of flow-on effects to produce all of these hormones that regulate our body through the endocrine system. So if you don't have that top level of ingredients, you're not going to be able to produce these things to run your body on a physiological level. So dietary fats are coming, like animal fat, butter, avocado, nuts, all that kind of thing. Vitamin D, obviously, it's coming from the sunshine, so we need to charge from the sun. And all of the minerals are coming from our foods, hopefully, but probably not anymore at the stage we're at. So all of that has to be present in our system, and then things like selenium needs to be added in when you're having iodine to convert it into the right hormones. So it's quite a complex system. So what is energy? So energy is the ability to do work, do something. It can't be created, it can't be destroyed. It's only transforming from stage to stage, state to state. And the different types of energy, kinetic energy is what we described before, that's coming from movement. And then chemical energy is burning a fuel, burning your food, your ingredients. Elastic is coming from stretching something and it's releasing electrons. Radiance coming from the light, and thermal coming from heat. So there's all different types of energy. And then potential energy is energy that's stored that hasn't been released. And that can be stored within a force field, gravitational, electric, or magnetic. And all electrical energy is potential energy that has been converted. We're defining terms, so it goes on to be easier to understand. So voltage is a measurement, and it's a measurement of the electric potential energy per unit. And electrical current is the movement of the electrical energy from place to place, and that's the electrons moving back and forth between all of the atoms. So one scientist I've been researching, because I use one of his machines in my clinic, is George Lipkowski. He was around in Paris in the early 1900s, and he was experimenting on biological beings, or observing biological beings, and what happens when radio waves and radio frequencies are affecting them. And he did this drawing, which is showing positive and negative charge of different types of earth. So with things like sand, it has a negative charge, and clay has a positive charge. And what that means is that if the earth you're on has a positive charge, it's sending energy away. And so this kind of, if you're living on this kind of land, you're actually getting illnesses more easily because you're sending energy away. And if you're living on some type of earth that's attracting with a negative charge, you're actually bringing energy into you and you're becoming more healthy. And then what this image is showing is that there's a lightning bolt coming from the sky between the positive and negative types of soil. And he says that that's when those two are side by side, positive and negative, that's where the electricity from the sky, the thunderbolt, will hit the earth. That's what we're aiming for. He also described three sources of radiation. So there's cosmic, atmospheric, and telluric. So telluric is the earth, and that's what the earth is producing naturally. That's what we live on. And something cosmic is coming from outside of the ionosphere, outside the Earth, coming from all the planets and stars, and it's penetrating into our sphere. And then the atmosphere is the part in between, and that's where we live. So we're constantly adjusting, every single cell adjusting from the telluric forces, the cosmic forces, and the atmospheric changes in between, and we're constantly monitoring and changing ourselves within that. So that's what we have to sort of combat every day. But if it's inside of nature, that's where it's meant to be. So this is another drawing of George Lukowski showing the top one is a cell, and it's showing the little filaments inside the cell, the little squiggly worm thing. That's actually containing all of this seawater substance with the minerals that we need, and it's covered like a shell with fatty substance, which is like an insulator. So you can imagine that the liquid and the minerals inside are like a wire, and then the fat around is like an insulator. So it's kind of just like electricity that you see with a plug. So that's stored inside the nucleus of the cell. And then also on the outside of the cell, we also can hold a conductive electric charge and store it like a battery. So every one little cell has a little battery. So just, we're a rechargeable battery, okay, basically. And the bottom picture is just a close-up of the central coil inside the nucleus. So we need ingredients, as I described before, to make the hormones, to act as messengers, to send signals around the body. So T3 is controlling the voltage of a cell membrane. T2 controls the mitochondria, which is inside the cell. The fat is the insulation. And salts, as we showed in the experiment, and other crystals in the water are conducting substances. So if we don't have the ingredients in the cells, we're not going to be able to conduct electricity. And then we're going to be running on essentially a low battery. So operating on 1% low battery, do we really want to be doing that? How do we measure this? According to Jerry Tennant, he's a doctor that healed himself of an inflammatory brain condition when he got an infection from operating on a patient. And he healed himself through using voltage and electricity to, because his idea was that if I can fix one cell, then I can fix all my cells. So he really started focusing on this theory. And he discovered that pH, you know, you've got alkaline, acidic, and neutral. pH is actually a measurement of voltage inside a liquid. So he's converted that into millivolts. So neutral pH is 7.35 to 7.45. And then if you put that on a scale, that's 0 is acidic and 14 is alkaline. So we want to be in an alkaline state. When you convert that into volts, the neutral pH is negative 20 to negative 25 millivolts. That's neutral millivolts. So that's what you require in normal. If you're not healing, you're not sick, you're just in neutral, that's what your millivolts should be at for each cell. But if you've got a trauma or an injury or an illness that you need to produce new cells for, you need to go into the alkaline state and you need to double that. So you need to go up to negative 50 millivolts. And if that voltage drops below the normal, negative 20 to negative 25, you're in the disease state. So basically your batteries are so low that you can't start, you can't make new cells, you can't keep up with just a normal function. And then if it's below plus 30, that's in the really acidic, that's the cancer stage.
Yeah. Where do you measure the
plus and
minus?
Where do you measure it?
How do you measure
this? I don't know. This is, yeah, I haven't gone into that depth. So like you're talking about how you measure yourself?
Yeah, how do you measure the cell? Because you come up with plus and minus, you have to measure it.
Yeah. So he's measuring, I guess, will be the voltage output.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I go on this kind of surface level, I grab lots of things. So I haven't delved into like real electrical.
The pH of the blood. Aren't you measuring the pH of either the blood or the
interstitial
fluid?
I'm not sure what exactly you measured.
Blood doesn't connect to the cell.
Yes.
So the information of the blood level is not the same information.
Yeah, but I think there's a correspondence.
There's an electric potential between inside and outside of the cell. I'm not sure if that refers to that.
We'll find out later.
You have to look and you have to say.
It's going to go on the next one. So, what is frequency? Frequency is a measurement, and it's a measurement of movement in a time frame. So, on that, it's showing on the left side, it's got hertz, and on the other side, it's got tesla. So, when I'm talking about hertz, we're referring to the hertzian measurement, not the tesla measurement. That's another thing that I don't know much about. But it's basically a frequency is how many times in 1 second hertz a thing will do one rotation or one oscillation. So if something's going around in 1 second, one time, that's 1 hertz. If something goes around 100 times in 1 second, that's 100 hertz. If it goes around 1 billion times in 1 second, it's 1 billion hertz, which is called gigahertz. So that's what I just said. It's measured as oscillations, which is movements or cycles per second. So that's shown in these waveforms. So you can see that the red one on the left is a big slow wave. So this is a slower waveform. And then it's going up to higher and higher. So the faster something moves, the more close together this movement is going to be. So breaking down hertz, kilohertz, megahertz, gigahertz, that comes in handy when we start talking about 5G and what is normal frequency range of humans, and then what is all of these other frequency ranges that we're living inside of that are maybe not so natural anymore. Waveforms producing different shapes. Not everything's a sine wave. With digital, it's a square wave, so it's pushing things on and off like a binary. But nature produces sine waves. Nature produces, you can see it in everything. It's in the water, it's in everything you can observe in the grass, everything is rolling hills, there's no square lines in nature. So this is an example of octaves producing the waveforms. Nature doesn't produce straight lines. And it's so what is normal? Schumann, he measured the resonant frequency of the Earth that we all refer to as 7.83 hertz, and that's what the Earth is naturally producing. And it starts at 7.83, it goes into the ionosphere, which is between the Earth and the outer Earth, the atmosphere that we live in, and it's starting at 7.83 and it's going up, it's reaching about 33 point something and it's coming down. So we're in this cycle of 7.83 to 33 hertz. That's our natural state that we should be inside of, and that's what our body and our blood connects to, and our heartbeat connects to, is this naturally producing frequency. So just to give different examples of different frequency ranges, beta, that's when we're in this state, we're talking, we're operating between 14 and 30 hertz in the brain. Alpha is when you're going more into a meditative state, when you put an acupuncture needle in, you feel quite relaxed and sleepy. You're going into alpha. Below delta, 4 hertz, theta, 4 to 8. And gamma is when you're meditating and connecting more superconsciously, you go through the. So, cymatics, most people know about it, but this is a metal tray and it's got some sand or something like that on it, and the guy's got a violin bow and he's making the vibration, and that tray is producing a pattern. And so that's what cymatics is, it's observing the patterns from vibration of matter. So here's another modern example. He's connected up to his system with a metal plate, and every tone on that piano will produce a different pattern, because every tone produces a different frequency, a different speed, and it's going to produce different shapes.
Could you go back to the telegraph and the different brainwave patterns?
Uh-huh.
Because gamma is actually not a brainwave pattern.
Okay.
It's a cosmic radiation, which is very deadly, and it has much higher frequencies. And actually, the pattern perception and the like in the Delta area.
Mm-hmm.
And this is when all the psychokinesis and all the telepathy and all that appears. And actually, above beta, it's actually panic and death. Beta is already panic, like stress, panic, and death.
Okay,
so,
yeah, it's a super lucid state. Like when you're in a car crash and everything goes really super slow, that's the end.
Yeah,
we'll discuss after. I'm like, for me, I'm still learning all this stuff. I'm compiling a lot of information to tell a story.
Mm-hmm.
The little minute details, I'm never going to know more. So thank you. And keep updating as I learn things life. But this is showing the cymatics in a water molecule. When you think about that you're made of water, and everything that you tone, you say, you're exposed to, in every moment, you're constantly changing. So your water molecules are producing different patterns all the time, depending on who you're talking to, the emotion you're feeling, if it's anger, if it's sadness, if it's happiness. You're going to be producing little patterns all the time. And this can be seen in ancient artwork. I don't know if that was the right information. It's just an example for the picture. Some more ancient cymatic interpretations. This is what you'd see in churches and mandalas and things like that. So all around us in all of these ancient buildings and ancient artwork, it's just in your face, basically, all the time. So again, every single one of those is a different tone, and that's inside different culture again. So the human body is like a musical instrument, if you think about it in that way.
Can I share an experience on that?
Mm-hmm.
I just tripped one time and I could see when people spoke those crests, their family crests, like a cymatic imprint of different colours.
Really?
Coming up, yeah, with every person at a different one coming out. And it seemed associated with where they were from, because there was French people and English people on it.
So like French people would have a similar looking one?
Similar colours, or just the colour bandwidth. Yeah. Everyone's one was different, but it was just interesting. I thought it was, when they spoke, I could see it. That's what I, perhaps that's what the family crest thing actually is your, what I thought was use your biological technology that you've been carrying from your ancestry, because of the words they spoke and all the beliefs and whatever is like.
Yeah, so just reinforcing the same thing. Different frequency, different pattern, and then different expression inside material matter. So Fabian Maman is another guy that I've been using some of his research in my work. He's first a musician, touring musician, playing to a lot of live crowds. And then he had an acupuncture experience. He decided to learn acupuncture, and then he started doing some experiments on live human cells in the petri dish with a microscopic camera and a Carolean auric field camera. So these are examples of what he photographed on cells. He played different sounds with different instruments and different tones and different frequencies. They were only acoustic, he didn't do anything digital. But he discovered that different tone would produce a cellular shape change and a different light emission, and use different instruments such as guitars, xylophones, human voice, all different types of activation. And then he got some healer cancer cells, and he photographed those and played sound to the cancer cells. And what he discovered was, first he started just playing a gong, and it didn't. It was just a gong for 21 minutes, and after 21 minutes the cancer cell wall disintegrated and the cancer cell exploded. And then the next one he did was playing the tone A, I think it was with a xylophone, in the same tone, A, same time, 21 minutes, the cancer wall exploded. Then he started playing the scale, going up and up the scale and repeating the scale, and that shrunk the time down to 14 minutes where that cell wall would disintegrate. And then his last one was using the human voice as the instrument and going up the scale, and that the healing time destroying the cancer cell wall down to 7 minutes. So if you think about it, if the human voice is the most powerful instrument we have, you vibrate all of that water in your body to change all of those cymatic patterns and to just, you know, blast out anything that needs to be shifted. So this is G on his name, and he's sitting in between the coils of a machine called the multi-wave oscillator, and it's one that I use in my clinic back in New Zealand. So there's two separate coils, you sit between them like these are two antenna, and they're creating a field, and you sit in that field. The big one producing bigger, slower frequencies, up into the smaller one in the center producing higher frequencies. So you can imagine that each one of those rings is like a tone on the piano, and when you play all of the notes on the piano, you're capable of producing many harmonics, many different waveforms, patterns, sounds, and when they're all played together and they start interfering with each other, they're capable of producing even more interferences and harmonics. So because every one of your cells, 200 quintillion, if we believe what George Lukoschewski says, if every one cell has a different, slightly different material structure, it's going to be moving at a different speed to all of the other cells. Maybe the liver cells have a certain, you know, frequency range. My eye cells have a different one. My hair cells, my bone cells, all different frequencies. This machine gives like a bath of frequencies, so all of those cells can choose their resonant frequency and come into resonance. So it increases the strength, the amplitude of the healthy cellular movement. So what resonance is when there's a natural vibration of something, and when it comes into its natural vibration, it will get stronger, it will increase in amplitude. When things go out of the normal vibration, they're not strong anymore. So this is basically helping the healthy cells come into their normal resonance so they will then become stronger.
What frequency do you use?
I'm trying to find that out. In his handbook, he says it's going from between 750,000 to 250,000 megahertz, I think, up into 3 gigahertz. Broad range. But because his research was lost, that people have been trying, like Tom's written the handbook on this machine, people have, you know, been trying to figure out his magic secrets. So yeah, how does it work? It's basically a resonance machine, sender, receiver, antennae, and 750,000 hertz to 3 billion hertz. So yeah, basically strengthening healthy cellular movement. Also, it has a third little coil that sits on the ground, and that has a wire that goes out and it plugs into the roots of the tree. So it's also using the earth energy in that. So this radiant energy produced by this machine, the original one was set up in the golden ratio with all those nested coils, and you can see that obviously it's mirroring what nature is producing in the Fibonacci sequence. That second picture with the DNA battery is from Jerry Tennant's presentation, and it's looking down the axis of a DNA coil, and it's showing that this DNA coil is producing the Fibonacci as well. Enforcing natural movement is what this machine is doing. And that movement also is causing energy to feed back to itself. It's an implosion, so it's recycling itself. It's not losing energy, it's not going out, it's containing it. So, moving into human circuitry systems, this is Alex Gray's painting. It's showing organs, nerves, vessels, bones and things like that, blood vessels, chakras and acupuncture channels. So places in the body where there's a crevice. It's like when the river's flowing and it reaches a pole and it travels down the river, it goes to the next pole. And when you find acupuncture points, you actually form in a hole. So they're not just forming lines. They're based on the structure. And these facial lines are actually what the acupuncture meridians are following as well. And then that top picture there of that spiderwebby looking stuff, that's called fascia or connective tissue, and that's what's under our skin that's connecting everything together, and it's completely alive and moving. So if you watch a documentary called Strolling Under the Skin, some French scientists videoed under there, they got little cameras and they showed live real-time footage of the fascia moving as the body moves. These things are more elastic. They kind of stretch and then they'll attach and they'll come back again like elastic. So, you know, your body's like this constantly changing, alive, conscious organism. So it got me thinking about describing that inside that nucleus of that cell, it's more like a wiring system. So when you look at a muscle, you could see it exactly like this wire. So the anatomy of a muscle is looking like this. The anatomy of a wire is looking like this. There's a muscle. So these muscles move and stretch with that connective tissue around them and connecting, then giving this kind of elastic energy. So I like making patterns, shapes, just putting things together. This is wires, but they're also looking exactly like arrangements of muscles. So our human body is an electrical wiring system on an organic level. So Duryodhana was saying as well that the muscles, which are all made up of cells, obviously, and the cells contain voltage, and when we do kinetic energy, we're recharging those cell batteries. And the muscles are like the battery packs, and they store the electrons, the generated charge. And those battery packs connect to the organs, because all the acupuncture meridians connect to the organs and then they go out into the muscles. So when you move your body, you're actually charging up your battery packs, which connect to your organs. So you're a completely rechargeable system. So another example of a circuit in the human body is obviously a heart. Deoxygenated blood comes in after it's been used in the body. The lungs send oxygen in, it gets oxygenated in the heart, and it gets sent out the other way and oxygenates the body. So this is another example of a circuitry system in the body. And then spinal nerves, they're also supplying energy to our body through another circuitry system. So we've got a lot going on. So all of these spinal nerves that come out of the middle of your spine, they're going into your brain, your organs, your arms, your legs, everything. And that's conducting electricity, and that's running around. Another circuitry system, this is a teeth chart. So in Chinese medicine, they've identified that every single tooth is linked to a different organ, and also it's linked to a different spinal nerve. So if you've got a cavity in a tooth, you can imagine these are the circuitry system connecting into the organs, and the teeth are like the fuse box. So if a cavity happens in a tooth, you're actually shorting out the circuitry system for that organ that is linked to that particular tooth. So things like root canals and fillings and all of that kind of thing, they're drilling through the insulation and they're basically leaking voltage. So if you imagine you've got a tooth, here's the actual tooth, and inside that's the nerve, and that's the wire. You've got the tooth around, and if you drill into that and you put a metal filling, you're actually leaking out voltage through that metal filling. And so your organ is getting less voltage because you're losing it through your circuit breaker.
What about plastic? Well, these other fillings are non-metal.
I'm not sure. I have to find out more about that.
Yeah. And when you lose a tooth, or the tooth is pulled out?
Well, your tooth can regenerate according to, I forgot his name, he's done a lot of research on remineralizing your teeth with activated charcoal and things like that. So one girl I was talking to the other day said her holistic doctor said, don't get anything done to your teeth. Your body will fix it. Why does this particular chakra have that number of petals? And why does that chakra have that number of petals? I don't know enough about chakras to have all this historical knowledge, but it got me thinking about it in terms of motor or the energy movement inside the body. But the base chakra is said to have 4 petals, so that got me thinking about things I see in electricity and motors. This clover leaf thing on the right is an antenna, and so if these chakras, obviously, you know, we're processing through these, they're connected to our endocrine organs, which produce hormones, which produce emotions, emotional states, and they also send messages around the body. So if it is, you know, close to an antenna, it's sending and receiving information. So, depending on your perspective, like if you're looking down at something, that's a bird's eye view, it'll look a certain way. And then if you look from the side at something, it's going to look a certain way. And this is all antennae, the same antennae from different perspectives. But when you look at it from these different perspectives, it's kind of to me looking like the petals of the chakra in more of a mechanical way. And the chakras are known as wheels. Well, so what does a wheel do? The wheel rotates. So chakras linking to endocrine organs, making hormones, sending messages. There are also nerve plexuses where a lot of information is coming through from the body. A lot of nerves join up in these chakra areas. So we're processing, they're processing places. Is this a 6th petal chakra? I don't know. It's just another mechanical rotational wheel. Just looking at patterns, what is this for? If it has a structure, if the base chakra has got 4 petals, what is its function? That's my thinking. The structure always has to determine the function. For me, when I think about it, if the base is doing, maybe it's starting off with this 4 petal movement, it's the start of something, it's engaging the energetic movement. We're standing on the ground with our feet, we're drawing telluric energy through our body from our feet, and it first meets in this base chakra, which kind of, in my mind, it's like starting the engine. So you engage the first chakra and you start the engine, and the engine starts moving. And then you come up to the next one, which maybe has 6 petals, and when you move from 4 and click gears, it will produce a 6. And so maybe this is kind of like a gyroscopic click, click, click. And every time you're moving energy up and up and up, you're clicking into a new kind of operation of mechanical movement. Which got me thinking, when you get to the top of these chakras, after the throat chakra, you come into the third eye chakra, which is said to have 2 petals. So why has it gone from 4 petals, building, 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 up and numbers of petals, and then suddenly it goes back down to 2, and it got me thinking about structure. So the spine is basically, we'll see in the later slides, the spine is made out of donuts, if you can really dumb it down. So these are where the main chakras are located, but then when you come up to the base of the spine, you come into the brainstem, the third eye's up here, it doesn't have that structure anymore, the spine's finished. So it's got me thinking, you know, is this the antenna that is the third eye? crown chakra, which is said to have 1,000 petals or 144 or 144,000, that one is actually pointing in a different direction. And when you align everything up and then start the engine, everything's processing, and then you flip that, you basically plug yourself into the universal energies once you align your internal system. So this is that in a viewpoint of the cosmic forest field. So polarity and positive negative interaction of magnetic fields. So so positive and positive repel and positive and negative retracting. So magnetic fields, where an object exhibits a magnetic influence, the fields affect neighboring objects along things called magnetic field lines. Magnetic objects can attract or push away another magnetic object. So another structure, this is a coil, it's called a solenoid, and it's basically you're wrapping a wire around in this coil, and then you feed electricity through that. It's producing a magnetic field, and there's a positive and negative charge at each end. So, and then when you take that tube solenoid and you join it back together, this is producing a torus field, and that's this using this implosion energy, so it's not wasting anything. Nothing's leaving the circuit. It's you're able to add in. So a toroid has more inductance for a given number of turns than a solenoid, with a core of the same material and size. So if you're in this toroidal structure, the same amount of energy is going in, but it can hold more, so it's more efficient. And I found this, so if humans, we have a positive and negative charge producing these toroidal fields, and what are they doing? It's, in a way, it's nature's design to ensure that we can read each other, we can read these fields before we even meet each other. That's where the information is stored in this field. And so we don't bump into each other. So an example of a toroid that I've identified in the body is the structure of the spine. So every vertebra of the spine, I'm seeing it like a mini torus field, because the spinal fluid flows through the hole. And then the structure of it is more like this torus donut. So it's a way of keeping energy in the body, so it's not wasted and leaked out. And this is our structure. So depending on, so the structure of the spine, the bigger bones are at the bottom, and they're going up to smaller bones at the top. And so coming back to, you know, frequency measured and hertz, a bigger object is going to produce a different frequency range than a smaller object. So coming up the spine, you're going to be having different frequency fields, different magnetic fields coming out at all these different levels, because the size of the actual structure is different. And then people have done lots of tables, I don't know who's right, who's wrong, but they're measuring different frequencies according to every individual vertebra. So, who knows? So, that's how I'm sort of seeing the chakra system and the spine, because it's going from a large to a small, and it's moving, and it's changing gear. Every time it moves up, it changes gear, produces a different output. So this is a Helmholtz coil, and this is those toroids, which we described before. And so that's a toroid, it's like a donut, the north charge and the south charge, positive and negative. And these coils, when you put them together, they're producing a magnetic field running between them. And this is one of the machines I use in my clinic as well. There's a pulse, yeah?
They're magnetic rings.
Yeah, so I'll show you. North and south.
So
that's
that they would attract together, or they would attract each other?
Depending on what you're doing. it's like if you put two batteries together, so the positive and positive are going to repel, and then the positive and negative will attract. So the top one of that will be north, south, and then north, south. So south on the bottom and north on the top would be attracting. Yeah, so this machine I've developed with a friend of mine for the clinic, this is an example of the Helmholtz coil. So this has got a wire running in, copper wire, and it's wound around 300 times, and then it comes back out, and that's creating that circuit. And then basically you're putting, so you can put this on your body around a joint, and that's going to produce this magnetic field with your body in between. So the next slide is showing that it's been used, approved by the FDA in 1979, and treating all types of conditions, depression, anxiety, certain functional problems, emotional problems, injuries, multiple sclerosis, carpal tunnel, arthritis, on and on. So what it's doing is it's talking to the cell membrane, and it's helping to increase the transcellular uptake from the cell membrane, so your cell is actually able to do its functions faster. So this is an experiment, I think it was done in New Zealand with rabbit bone. So on the left side, they had a rabbit bone. They've punched a hole out. You can see it's like a square punch, which is such a great distance, your bone's not naturally going to grow back together. It's too far apart. So the one on the left was with no treatment, just seeing what the bone would do in its own self-healing process. And then the one on the right with pulse magnetic therapy has joined itself back together after 28 days. I'd have to look at the study to know all of the parameters of how frequently they treated and what the frequencies were, etc. But one example that I've had in my clinic, my friend who made this machine for me, he had nerve damage for about 10 years, and he had like no sensation on his thigh. And the nerves that connects to is in the lumbar spine, so that's the peripheral nerve, lateral cutaneous femoral nerve, and it was completely numb. And so he started using this machine, and he put it just side by side like that on his leg 5 minutes a day. And after a few weeks, he started getting a pain up here. So it was activating his nerves so much, it was overstimulating. With this kind of stuff, you need a day on and a day off, because your body needs to cycle return to its new homeostasis. So I told him to go every second day, and that pain stopped, and then this improved. Now he has full function of the dead nerve within 2 months, and it's still good. So, in all sorts of conditions. And I like this quote. This is from Steve Richards. He's an Aboriginal healer. The body is made of mostly water, and that water retains its memory through the electrical waves collected that pass through it. And understanding that the body contains all of the elements of matter, including iron and other metals, understanding that metals, when charged electrically, become magnetic, and that magnetic fields can wipe the memory from electrically stored memory. So this is essentially like a self-healing process. So we're made of water, it stores memory. And then if you, this is talking about how these work as well, this is a pulse magnetic field. When you pass a pulse magnetic field over a stored memory, which could be pain or trauma or some emotional thing that's stored in that water, when you pass a magnetic field over that, it can actually reset and wipe the memory in water. So it's helping to do that. Not a scientific paper, but I get that one. Just wipe the field, and that's so moving into why are we getting sick. Toxins are coming from the air we breathe. That's showing all of these pollutions coming from agriculture and sprays and everything. Diet, we're not getting adequate nutrients anymore. Since 1893, I think the Codex Salmonteris was established in Austria. They've been systematically taking nutrients out of food. They actually stated in this codex that all food containing nutrients is to be considered toxic to humans. So to protect humans from toxins, we're going to take out the nutrients, which are toxins, and they've been doing this since then with a whole bunch of other stuff you can read about in that. The Codex Alimentarius is pretty scary, and it's what we're living in right now. We're not really getting nutrients anymore, so we can rely on pharmaceutical companies to fix us, but all we really need is the right ingredients coming from the right minerals without the toxins brought in. So toxins coming from the air, the diet, all sorts of things we're breathing in. Trauma, broken bones and scars as well. Scars can, like if you go back to the acupuncture channels and those facial lines, if you have a scar in a channel, a scar is like an iceberg. So you see the iceberg on the water and it's like this, but below the water surface it's like that, it's two-thirds deeper. So any major scar you've got in your body is actually inhibiting the circuitry system, and you're getting less voltage to your organs. So fixing the scars is an important part of healing as well. So you've got to get in the right nutrients, you've got to unblock the circuits so the energy can flow with ease. Lowered voltage, which we talked about with Jerry Tennant, if you're going below that millivolt measurement in pH, you're into this low battery state and you can't replenish yourself, you can't build new cells, you can't heal. And then emotions and, you know, emotional traumas and mental things, that all gets stored in the electromagnetic fields of the body, and that blocks circuitry as well, that blocks the water flowing because it's like frozen. Also things like cold. If you've got cold in your body and you're made of water, what is happening to water when it's freezing cold? It turns to ice, so nothing's going to move. So a lot of people having cold icy drinks and cold salad from the fridge and lots of cold things, you're actually killing your digestive fire, because that fire needs to cook the food. And if you keep dumping ice on a fire, you're eventually going to put that fire out. You're not going to be able to cook anything anymore. So thinking about things like that. Chemical sprays, vaccinations, and all the stuff that they put in those, barium and strontium, they actually sit inside your body and they attract Wi-Fi frequencies, so you're actually conducting. So if you've got that in your body, you're actually more susceptible to reacting to the harmful Wi-Fi frequencies. Aluminium is getting lodged in the brain if it's mixed with fluoride. Fluoride helps it cross the blood-brain barrier, and then aluminium gets lodged in there. Things like autism and Alzheimer's and all those cognitive problems is because of the toxic overload. And then mercury sits on the, if this is a cell, that's the cell wall. The wall of the cell has a door, and the door is called a receptor, and that allows nutrients to pass in. And if these metals sit in those doorways, nutrients can't get in. And specifically with mercury, if mercury is sitting in the door, magnesium can't get in. And magnesium is a really important mineral that we need for most of our cellular function. So magnesium also helps to balance calcium in the cell. So if you have a cell with no magnesium, you've got too much calcium, and then you've got all of this calcification, bone problems. So we don't need more calcium for bones, we need more magnesium. Electromagnetic fields. So that's what we're made of water, and the minerals inside the water are conducting electricity. And then when you move electricity through that, like these coils, through the spine, through all of the structures in our body, that produces magnetic fields. So that is the unseen fields that we all carry around. You know, we talk about the physical, mental, emotional bodies. These are actually where we can store unseen things like emotions. It can be stored in physical as well. Yeah, so if you know, when you're sitting in meditation and you turn into your body and you feel a pain, and most people push it away, but if you tune into that pain and you really start feeling what it feels like, and just from a really objective place and really tuning into it, it will often start releasing old memories. I haven't thought about that person in 20 years when they said that rude thing to me, and then that pain will change. So understanding it like that, we can store everything like a computer, and if we don't clean up our computer, we just keep adding in Google images and videos and all this stuff that keeps clogging up the filing system. So
would you have the same experience using the electrical device as
actually feel much going on with these.
Yeah.
And I use it as like an adjunct to using acupuncture needles, getting people to tune into the feeling, which will release the memory. But you have to be able to feel it. It's all about feeling. This is just adding voltage and clearing. So it's like an accessory.
So would you say without the awareness you could not actually release memories?
And in my experience with my own healing and helping other people, the acknowledgement of the event and the embodiment of the emotional experience that you probably pushed away and wanted to not connect to is really important to help clear. So I'm sure there's lots of healers that can just do like this and I find it's really cathartic for people to be able to understand why this is there, because no healer heals anyone else. The body heals itself. We just have to give the aid, the guide to direct. And if you've been closed off to something for years, you don't even know it's there. You've got a sore back for years and years, and then you realize that it was attached to this experience when you were like 5 or 14. And then all that stuff, realization comes up, and then you can finally let go of it with understanding. So I think that's really important. This image is showing the cell wall with the receptors, with the doors. So nutrients passing in and out easily, and toxins blocking. So this is mercury, aluminium, blah, 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 all the stuff they put in vaccinations, and all the things they put in the water, and chemical sprays.
Can you put that around the brain?
I need to do more research on using it on the brain. There are machines that do it, but I think they're using different waveforms and different frequencies. Generally with these things you don't put them either side of the midline. But no, I haven't used it on the heart. I won't do that. Just to set it up. Yeah. Not using with people with a pacemaker or pregnancy or anything you don't want. This is that same ingredients map again. The red writing is showing how these toxins block the production of the hormones. So heavy metals are basically blocking up the zinc, the magnesium, the vitamin B's and C's. All the other vitamins, basically the metals are just stopping everything getting into the cells. And the, with the iodine, we need iodine, which is salt, to run our thyroid. And our thyroid is our immune system, and it's producing hormones for running our immune system and our digestive system. So if we are blocked from absorbing iodine, we can't run our digestion in our immune system. So unseen threats, obviously that's all the Wi-Fi signals and radio waves that we can't see. This is an app you can get on an iPhone called Architecture of Sound, and you can literally like look around and it will show all of the frequencies that are present to the unseeing eye. And it's getting kind of messy because they just, with all of this technology that we're using, we keep adding in and adding in and adding in, and it's just getting basically filling up this ionosphere between the earth and the heavens. So back to Wi-Fi, this is an experiment where they put some sprouts next to a Wi-Fi router and the healthy ones away from it, and the ones next to the router didn't grow. So if this is doing this to a plant, what's it doing to an animal, a bug, a person, any biological life?
Nanoscale, made it amorphous, so it can actually get right into the cells and detox,
research on the pulse magnet machines that it can actually help to pulse the heavy metals off the cell wall. So you can, if you do chelating processes like taking spirulina and chlorella and extraction through the gut, you can pulse the heavy metal, essentially doing like this, shaking off, and then it gets goes to be detoxed through the liver, and then it's going to go out through the digestive system. And if you have in your digestive system the chlorella, the spirulina, the things that bentonite clay attracts the bacteria and the toxins onto it, and you can excrete it out through the colon. So you can use this tech for getting it out. So in combination with zeolites and all that stuff. Yeah. I've been using another machine I made, which is basically a bucket, and then speaker wire, insulated speaker wire, wound around the whole bucket about 100 meters, and then you attach that. It's just attached to a power source, like a laptop adapter, and then you're filling that up with water, and then like white vinegar, DMSO, mineral salts, things like that, and then you turn it on, and that's actually helping to extract the metals out. And I've tried it on quite a few people, including myself, and if you put a drop of oil in there, after a few minutes that oil will start turning all sparkly, and it's all of those metals coming out of your body.
So you put your feet in the bucket.
Yeah, and then you turn on the coils on the outside, and it's insulated with duct tape, and you fill it up with water, and then you know.
And it doesn't matter what frequency you're putting through it?
No, it's just the, yeah, I mean, I'm sure there would be
18 volts or something you're saying on the laptop.
I think it's 240.
Is it different than the Japanese technique of putting your feet in the water against dark?
Yeah, I've seen those pads. They have different
minerals,
different things inside.
It's
same
sort
of concept.
Okay.
But I learned that bucket idea from a guy over in Canada who has Morgellons, and he does a lot of like heavy metal detox protocols to try and, I guess, with the electrical charge, it would attract metal rather than other things. So, but I know in, there's other things. I think in traditional Indian medicine, they use a kansa wand, which is a three-metal implement, and they put ghee on their feet and then massage the feet with this wand made out of, I think it's brass, copper, maybe zinc, and that turns the feet black as well. So there's all different ways to, and that's creating, you know, if you imagine you've got an oil substance on your feet and you've created a little field and you charge that up, it's sort of creating the electromagnetic pole.
I had an album exactly like that while meditating, rubbing my feet onto magnet metal, and then my feet gets black, and so I'm like, why am I doing this? Now I understand. It's like some weird stuff that comes down, you're like, why am I doing this?
Detoxing. This chart is showing hertz, kilohertz, megahertz, gigahertz, radio waves, microwaves. So once you get up to the high megahertz and going into the microwaves, it's producing thermal effects. So if you can imagine you're made of water, and you can imagine what happens to when you put water inside a microwave. And if you're living inside this frequency field that is basically putting these frequencies into you, which you're made of water, you're getting a thermal effect. So it's cooking you, literally. That's what's happening with all these things that you're getting added into us. So talking about the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 G, understanding what that is. So 1G was when we had cell phones in the 80s with voice capability, 2G, voice and text, 3G, voice, text, internet, 4G, voice, text, internet in a more advanced way. But 5G is a completely different system, and that's what is happening right now while a lot of these discussions are going on. Because 5G is not going to be in the same way, like we have these radio towers that emit the signal, and the closer you stand to that signal, the stronger your connection will be on your phone or whatever. The further away you are, the weaker the connection gets. So all the people living under that cell phone tower, they're getting cancer, but the people living in the countryside, they're not, because they're not exposed to the same radiation level. But the 5G system is a completely new system, and it that's been identified. If you watch Sasha's film, there's a really good summarization, good overview of different research science on what is actually happening. And one of the people he interviews in that film is named Mark Steele, who I've been listening to a lot of his discussions. He's a military technical weapons expert, and he's also an inventor, and he invents helmets that protect people from getting lasers in their eyes and all sorts of militarily based tech. So he's been doing a lot of research into it. So this stuff I haven't updated. There's a few updates I need to put after, but currently they're saying that 4G is 1 to 4 gigahertz range, so that's in that microwave range. So for the last 20 years, there's been a lot of people having these reactions. I don't like using a cell phone. I can actually feel it producing heat in my hand when I touch it, and I start getting emotionally distressed. But now I know what it is, I can at least put it away and switch it off. But it does cause this emotional distress because it's harming me. It's ultra-high radiations. It's going to be using higher frequency levels, and aimed at amplified signals in a phased array system. So what that means is, instead of having that one tower, and if you're close by you've got a strong signal, it goes out weaker, what they're aiming to do, and what they've done in Mark Steele's town in Wales, is put them on every single lamppost, little tiny transmitters. And what that means is it's going to create a grid system that will blanket out, and no one can escape it if they're in this kind of grid system. So what they're proposing with 5G, you know, they're putting it under the guise of, oh, everyone's going to have stronger internet, everyone's going to be super connected and download faster and faster things, but it's actually so that they can put out this massive deployment of towers under the guise of helping us get the tech. So one thing that you can see this around the world, they've been doing it in Paris and Ireland, they're cutting down trees. People post it on Facebook, and suddenly a street, and it's all the trees have just been chainsawed and left like that. It's ridiculous. So what they're saying is, because so when you go up into microwaves and above 4 gigahertz, the waveform, like I showed in those first slides, a slow frequency has got a long waveform. A high frequency, it's moving faster, so it's got a really short waveform. It can't travel as long distance. So what they're saying is, for it to be able to transmit the signal from post to post, if there's a tree in the middle, the tree is going to get that signal and it's going to take it down into the earth, into the roots. So it's going to earth the signal. The signal can't get transmitted. So they're cutting down all the trees to allow the 5G signal to go through. And in Sheffield, England, apparently they've cut down half of their 36,000 trees for this project. There's stuff all over the internet about it. So microwaves traveling at 2.5 to 3 feet, and then the smaller microwaves, they're only traveling a shorter distance. So you need more transmitters to make the signal happen. But we already know around these cell phone towers that we've already got that the cancer rates are higher. Children are at risk to these frequencies because their skulls are thinner. So a woman, it's just a biological structure you can't protect. Cancers, tumours, neurological, reproductive, immune system issues are happening, and the plans are to do the whole world, basically. And another way that they're trying to say how it's going to help us is to create the Internet of Things, which is every single thing will be connected to the Wi-Fi. So everything in your house, every appliance, everything you buy will have a little barcode on it transmitting a signal. So if you open up your fridge, you use up the last of your milk and you put the milk in your rubbish bin, which also has a little signal on it, and you get a little pop-up on your phone saying, need more milk? Here's a discount on milk. This is according to Max Egan, who's an Australian social political commentator. And then they haven't tested it. There's no standards, there's no studies, there's no regulations, despite all of the harmful effects that have been shown in the last 10, 20 years with all of the other signals. And Tom Wheeler, he's the Federal Communications Commissioner, was quoted to say, we're not going to wait for the standards. And they just pulled him out, we're just going to do it. And it's basically a big social experiment that is already been proven to cause harm. According to Mark Steele, when you think about the phased array, the grid system, he's seeing it as a weapon. So, in his town of Gateshead, they're putting it on all of the LED streetlights, and it's emitting very high millivolts, which he says that humans should only be exposed to 200 millivolts of radiation within a 6-minute window. And this is actually exceeding that by more than 10 times. One woman he measured in her house, it had 4,000 millivolts in her bedroom, and she's sleeping in there, so she's not able to escape. All of his neighbours' kids are coming around saying they've got nosebleeds, all of this stuff is, you know, changing people. And the way it's, because nature's producing sine waves, they're using pulse modulated, so it's an on-off binary system, so that's actually doing like this on the cell. And if you imagine that you've got a jackhammer on some concrete and you turn that jackhammer on, eventually the concrete will break. So imagine it on a cell. And one thing that really freaked me out was that a frequency of 60 gigahertz, which is going to be used, is the frequency that we absorb oxygen into our bloodstream. So if you tap into that frequency and you put this pulse modulated signal into that, it could actually disrupt the oxygen bonding, and the oxygen, which is O2, it can actually separate and it will join onto other oxygen molecules and create a tree we can't breathe. Plus you're cutting down the trees anyway, so it's going to interfere with basic breathing. So Mark Steele and another man, Barry Trower, have been tracking for years, since 1963, they've been using these frequencies for crowd control. Phased array is basically, it's going to be able to move and scan, and it can actually scan through the walls of houses, it can scan through concrete, it can basically monitor people, it can pick up information through you, through your house. If you've got your cell phone on, it's going to be able to get information from you that way. And also Mark Steele's recently said that the whole high frequency thing is actually a bit of disinformation, that it's actually operating on 828 hertz, which is a really quite a long wave. It's not a gigahertz. Gigahertz is a billion cycles per second, but this is still operating in the low, so that low frequency is actually able to penetrate a deep, like a longer distance. So putting them closer together to say that the microwave needs the signal to travel is actually a lie. It's just so there's densification, so everyone's going to be affected. And then using this phased array on the carrier wave of 828, which is a big wave, and it's going to just basically, you can imagine, and if you're watching water in a river or on a lake, and there's a little duck swimming around, and he's making little, you know, things like this, and he's producing little waves, and then a big speedboat comes along and produces a huge big wave that's going to overpower the little ducks. So these bigger waves are going to come through with this phased array system. So it's not really about the frequency so much, it's about the way it's been used. So it's going back to the Schumann resonance, which is what the Earth is producing, 7.83 hertz. That's our natural state. That's where we're in harmony. That's when we're calm. That's when we're happy, functional, and in good health. And if we're using this pulse-modulated microwave, it's going to be affecting brain patterns, behavior, and this is why we're seeing all these people suddenly glitching out and then going and shooting everybody. You know, everyone's got a cell phone, everyone's taking medications which also produce frequencies in your body, and enough of this kind of contamination. They can also use this phased array system to target people and cause them to do behaviours like mind control, all of that good stuff. So there's a specific frequency for a specific emotion, a specific action. So can't feel it, but everyone's getting affected. So I'm going to finish with 5G and just talk about some other things. This is what I considered. I'm wondering what these buildings are for, because they were built for a reason, and they're built in a really beautiful way that it has to have a function. If our structure determines a function, then what is the function? Something like that. Is it just for going and praying to God? I don't think so. I think it's definitely some kind of technology. This is an example of structure. This is the Wardenclyffe Tesla Tower on the right, and it's showing that it's using the underground water aquifers for the electromagnetic generation, and using the atmospheric energy as well. So all around the world we have these ancient structures. We have churches, we have pyramids, we have all of them located on ley lines, which are the energy lines. And so if they're all there, and they're all from a time that we can't even remember what they're for, like no one, we're only just understanding in recent years that the pyramids are generating energy from the water that comes into them from caves under the pyramids, and we've got limestone caves, and water, when the Nile River used to flood those, water would come through, and the limestone and the water would create a piezoelectric charge, and then that charge is leading up into the pyramid, which is then potentially capable of putting out a lot of energy. So this is what people have got their minds into now, and no way used for tombs. I just realized we're on the wrong slide. Looking at these buildings, when you think about what we just discussed early on with cymatics, you know, the pattern that is produced from a tone. So when you vibrate matter, it produces a pattern. And you can see all that, and all of these beautiful buildings have got all these different patterns. And so what is this building for? So people stand in these places and they sing, or they chant, or they do some kind of voice resonance. But also what's coming in from the outside is the light is coming through these beautiful cymatic windows. So perhaps these buildings are like anti-resonance chambers that we're meant to use in a specific way. And every single different building has a different set of windows, different set of cymatic patterns, different tones. And if you sing the right song with the right building with the right pattern in the same moment, it's able to generate quite a lot of energy just from voice. And then these buildings as well also have pipe organs in them. So one guy, I watch a lot of his research, you know, he's thinking maybe these were sound healing buildings where you could pile a whole people from the town and then, you know, heal the whole town every week or something like that. But they're definitely, to me, the structure of them is so precise and so, how do we even do that? We can't build it now. It's definitely got a reason. So, one thing I found interesting this year is that Notre Dame was burnt, and it was burnt just after, in New Zealand, we had the Christchurch shooting in the mosque. So we had the Christchurch shooting in a mosque, and then the next week was the equinox, which is, the equinox is this part of the sun moving around the earth, happens twice a year, that's an energetic, important time. So you have a shooting, you have an equinox, which is kind of using the build-up to that to amplify whatever you're going to put into the public consciousness. It's in Paris, the City of Love. They've set this building on fire, and then at the same time in Jerusalem, there's another mosque on fire. Like, what is this doing to our psyche, where they're destroying a resonant building in the city? All the trees have been cut down to allow for 5G. There's a lot of focus on Paris with the yellow vests, and then suddenly all these things happen. So I'm always looking into, you know, that kind of consciousness as well. So structure determines function. So what's the function for this? This is inside of the Sagrada de Familia in Barcelona, Spain. That is looking up into the center of the roof. It looks like a machine to me. It's spectacular. And you can see on the ends the cymatic windows bringing in the light frequencies. So something there. And then here's another example of a temple. All these temples have on top, they've either got crosses, they've got stars, they've got always covered in copper or some kind of conductive material. And what these are called is resonators. So that is actually, when you have a resonator, it's able to vibrate at a certain range of frequencies. So that means it can bring in and send out in a certain range. So this is an example of people creating a field. So this is the Kaaba stone at Mecca, and every day, five times a day, Muslims pray in the same direction. What do you think that's doing? That's creating a huge energetic field, and that's going over the whole earth all the time. And I liken that to this word, an egregore. It's a thought form that enough people think collectively will actually turn into an entity or an energy. And this is, we've got all this religion stuff happening all the time, Christians, Muslims, and it's like, you can imagine that on a bigger scale of these energies interfering with each other, and it's like being in a washing machine. So yeah, resonator, that's basically something that will move at certain frequencies, and when it comes into resonance, it'll get stronger and it'll gain amplitude.
Resonator that converts the energy of the nano world into electricity. All other working resonators appeared very familiar. Tridents of Neptune, Zeus, Shiva, Harun, and other gods. All of them are symbols of power and energy. Is it an accident? This is the model of the nano world with an axis of symmetry. In this view, it's clear that the base of it is the Christian cross. In another view, the same axis forms the Jewish Star of David. The computer model will brighten this phenomenon. This is the rotation of the model of an electric propeller, so-called devil's wheel. In this one, clearly seen is a swastika. Science model of nano world unites the symbols of all the religions.
Sorry, I use that because we have these resonators on all of the tops of these buildings. Everyone's fighting about religion, but it's these all of this is really buildings that are harnessing energy. And it's not about religion at all. This is a misinterpretation of what these ancient structures could be used for. So just to finish up with, like, you know, discussing 5G and all this horrible stuff and how can we protect ourselves, and the fact that we're made of water, we're capable of changing that water based on what we say, what we think, how we move those molecules. It's about how we interact with these waveforms. So if there's something harmful coming towards me, and I tune in and I can feel that, what am I going to do with it? Am I going to try and protect myself from it? In sound, science of sound, basically, it's to do with waveforms. If you've got a waveform coming along like this, and then you've got a matching waveform coming along like this, they're going to join together and they're going to create a stronger wave. And if you have that same waveform, maybe it's coming out of a speaker, and you put the same one in opposite, but it's the same waveform, they're actually going to cancel each other out. That's called phase cancellation. So if we can kind of think about how we're handling ourselves in terms of, we're not going to run around having to protect ourselves and shield and protect. We have to do more than that. We have to almost transform it through and become like fire it back at itself in a way. Use this phase cancellation. See it, feel it, embody it, learn it, what is it, and then okay, now it's going back rather than having to protect. Because a lot of these things people are buying, like EMF protection, shell clothing, and protect. We're just still in the same problem. We're not. So this I'm putting at the end to kind of demonstrate what one human voice is capable of in one of those resonant buildings. She's in a church.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.